when retarded people live in supervised group homes, what do they do during the day? Debbie Poole assembles safety goggles. Goggles that will help keep other workers safe. Being retarded never stopped anyone from being a good neighbor.
If you're anywhere near my age, I'm sure you think about cancer now and then. The thing is, think sensibly about it. Know the facts about early detection, about tests you should have, about how to talk to your doctor. Know the facts.
Call toll-free 1-800-4-CANCER for the free publication Cancer Facts for People Over 50.
Do you remember playing on New York City streets? Can you remember Johnny on the Pony, Ringolivio? Were your days spent swimming in the East River or playing in the Coney Island Funhouse? Queens Council on the Arts is planning an exhibit all about play in New York. To share your memories with us, call 291-1100.
The Morning Show today at 9.
Everywhere you look these days, you will see people jogging. You may even see your local clergymen, since many ministers and rabbis have taken up the sport. Is this the kind of thing a man or woman of God should be doing? I believe it is. Jewish tradition understands that the body is the container of the soul. The healthier the body, the healthier the soul. For this reason, the philosopher Maimonides urged people to exercise lest they be afflicted with unnecessary aches and pains, which would distract them from fulfilling their obligations to God. We can easily criticize the person who is overpious. He ignores his physical well-being. We should be equally critical, however, of the person who puts too great a stress on sports. That person neglects his obligation to study, to pray, and help others through meaningful social action. The best thing is to strike a proper balance so we can honor our obligations to ourselves, the rest of humanity, and to God. Just as there is room for jogging in a religious life, there should be room for true religious values in jogging.
This is station WABC TV New York.
Additional funding provided by the Beneficial Corporation, a nationwide consumer credit services organization, and by Carter Wallace Incorporated.
New Jersey's Summer Fair is only one of 13's cultural treasures. The days ahead are overflowing with performances to delight the eye and ear, all made possible with the help of member dollars. Take a look.
Next time on Evening at Pop, special guest, Yo-Yo Ma. Celebrated cellist Yo-Yo Ma plays The Swan by Saint-Saëns and the Haydn C Major Cello Concerto with John Williams and the Boston Pops Orchestra next time on Evening at Pops.
That's tomorrow night at 8 on WNET Newark.
The best seats in the house are in your house, watching 13. Our new season means more baffling mysteries.
You must know. I don't go to the library. I make love to a doctor called Gerald Fitch.
More masterpieces. Our weekly film classics and films about film classics. A special presentation of Fassbinder's epic Berlin Alexanderplatz. And great performances of drama.
I owe you something, Jones. You behave better than the others.
Your friends, you mean?
I have no friends. These are acquaintances. And you mustn't think, by the way, that I dislike them. One dislikes one's equals. I despise them.
Dance and music. The shows go on and go on strong on 13 because you help keep us only the best.
This is the story of a single act of espionage which changed the balance of power in the Middle East. The reconstruction that follows is based on our own investigation and on the records of the principal participants. It happened between 1967 and 1969. This is a true story. At 11:30 on the morning of September 23rd, 1969, a top-level conference at Dubendorf Military Air Base, Switzerland, was interrupted. The Swiss Federal Police had come to interview one of the participants, Chief Engineer Alfred Frauenknecht.
Gentlemen, I'm sorry. Will you excuse me for a few moments?
Mr. Frauenknecht?
Yes.
Mr. Alfred Frauenknecht?
Yes.
We're from the Federal Police Department.
Gentlemen, I'm afraid there's been a mistake. I know the authorities in Bern. I've been trying to contact them all morning. They'll see this in a very different light.
To build a foreign engine, why French? Why not American?
I don't want it French. I don't want it American. I want it perfect.
Mr. Frauenknecht, telephone, please. Mr. Frauenknecht, telephone, please.
Yes.
Well, ask them. Always get the basic information.
All right, tell them I'm coming. I'm going to see Merkley. I'll tell you one thing. There's more hot air comes out of that office than comes out of that engine. You see, Mr. Merkley, the whole job is held up. Now, would it be possible for the administration department to do something about it quickly?
Look, I've been with Mr. Schmitz.
Okay, can we finish with the documentation? It's very important that we run these tests before we go to the Mirage conference.
I already said, I'll look into that. Now, this conference.
It's going to be a lot more difficult this time.
Oh, why?
The Israeli Six-Day War.
Yes, well, what I'm interested in right now is the Swiss Air Force. Can we get those documents quickly?
We're doing our best for you, Mr. Frauenknecht.
Thank you, Mr. Merkley.
And don't rush on. I haven't finished yet. Now, Mr. Schmidt wants us to be very careful about what we say at the Mirage conference.
I'm always careful.
Whatever our own feelings about the Arab-Israeli conflict, Mr. Schmidt says, quite rightly, that we mustn't offend either side. The French are very touchy too. We went through a lot to get that Mirage contract, and we don't want to offend them. And the Arabs? Well, we're selling millions of dollars worth of engines, diesels, turbines, all over the Middle East. As Mr. Schmidt says, our neutrality is our prosperity.
So we sell arms and whatever else to both sides. And then after the killing, we send in the Swiss Red Cross to clean up our image.
Alfred, don't draw me into a political fight. You know the situation. And the Red Cross
is no match for Arab oil.
Helped thousands of Jews during the war. Besides, the world has changed since then.
Until the Jews lose. And then the countries that don't want the Jews they've got keep out the refugees trying to get in.
Well, that may be. Just so long as we keep our feelings out of the conference, however sincerely we may hold them.
December 1967. The Mirage Conference, Paris.
Mr. Frankner.
Colonel Shaw.
Mr. Mackey.
Colonel Shaw. Lord Scott.
How are you finding the weather here in Paris?
The weather's all right. But the climate has become rather too chilly for my taste.
I suppose it's quite a lot warmer in Israel.
It's warm enough, yes.
But not as hot as it was. There we are, Colonel. Well, to old friends. I hope that cheers you up a bit.
I'll take a lot of cheering up. How would you feel if you had ordered and paid for 50 planes and De Gaulle embargoes the lot?
Yes, well, we all know what De Gaulle's up to.
How did the engines stand up to the fighting, Colonel Shaw?
So long as no one's shooting at them, they work fine. I know jet engine's going to be very happy with a big chunk of metal in it.
But your casualties were amazingly light.
Our pilots are very experienced.
I wish you'd pass some experience on to us. You said nothing all day.
What have the French or Lebanese ever done for us that we should give our good advice to them?
I guess they're not the French or the Lebanese.
That's true. Incidentally, your modification to the ignition system was excellent. It saved at least half a dozen of our fighters.
Good.
Well, let's sit down, shall
we? We do have one or two other suggestions, but perhaps they should wait for a more private room.
Good morning, Mr. Frankner.
Good morning, Mr. Schmidt.
Have you got my memo?
No, sir. I haven't been to my office yet this morning.
Oh, it's not urgent. I had a letter from Colonel Sherm, you know, the Israeli aircraft man.
Oh, yes.
He wants to visit us again. Says he wants to talk about Mirage engine parts.
I'm not surprised.
How can you run an Air Force without spares? They'll probably be making a few themselves, don't you think?
I've been thinking about that. He comes here so often, I don't think it compromises us to let him see the machines. Evidently, somebody called Colonel Kine is coming to make the arrangements. You handle it.
All right.
My name is Colonel Nachemia Kine. I'm with the Israeli embassy in Rome. Look, it's about the visit to Switzerland of Colonel Shaw. Oh, you know, good, good. Well, it's a little bit complicated. Well, Colonel Shaw is in Israel at the moment, so I thought it might be better if you and I were to meet to sort out the arrangements. Right, yes, well, I'll have to fly up, so what do you say we meet at Zurich? Yes, the ambassador's hotel. Right, next Tuesday, 8 o'clock. Fine, in the bar. I thank you, and goodbye, Mr. Frauenknecht.
Martini. No ice. How's Colonel Shaw?
I don't know. I haven't seen him for some time.
Well, I assumed you two worked together.
No, I'm based in Rome.
So you're what, then? European agent for Israeli aircraft industries. I'm surprised I haven't met you before.
No reason why you should. I'm not an engineer.
I'm with the military attaché in Rome, chief arms buyer. Look, I'd rather not discuss our business here if you don't mind. I suggest we finish our drinks and go up to my hotel. It's quieter there.
You come all the way from Rome just to arrange Colonel Shaw's visit.
I don't want to talk about Colonel Shaw. Look, I'll come straight to the point. Israel is in serious trouble. We may have won the Six-Day War, but we lost some planes and many more were damaged.
I thought you were claiming your losses were light.
Would you tell the Arabs that half your air force was grounded? Look, we need your help as the leading Mirage engine man outside of France.
That's very flattering, but I don't see how I can help.
Why should I flatter you? Look, we know you're the key man at Sulcis. In fact, many people in the Israeli aircraft industry were surprised when Merkley was made Smith's deputy instead of you.
You know about that?
Does the name Al Schwimmer mean anything to you?
Yes, of course.
Head of the Israeli aircraft industries, Al Schwimmer, Alfred Frauenknecht. Mr. Frauenknecht thinks we're exaggerating.
Mr. Frauenknecht, you know what happens when you fly planes strike after strike, flat out for 6 days. Nearly one third can be written off beyond repair. Another third need exhaustive refits. That leaves us rather naked. It's my job to get them back into fighting shape again. And I can't do that without the spare parts. Now, you're an expert engineer. You know the options. One, buy replacement planes from France. Impossible. De Gaulle's forbidden it, right? Two, buy spare parts from France. De Gaulle's forbidden even that. Three, make our own spare parts. It's very difficult.
Oh, I'm sure you'll find them somewhere.
Our survival can't just depend on the somewhere. Tiny country like ours must always have air superiority. No, if we have to strip down a Mirage and copy every piece it can take, maybe 9 or 10 years. If we have to, we'll do it. But by that time, the Arabs will have rearmed and smashed us.
But you've held out for 25 years.
The Crusaders held out for 200 years, but they were thrown out in the end. When it suited the Russians to recognize our existence, in 1948. They did it. And they supplied us with Czech weapons. But now, oil is the key, and they're pro-Arab. The Arabs never said peace in 1948, or at Suez, and they're not saying it now. We can't rely on UN resolutions or international goodwill. 3 million Jews surrounded by 50 million Arabs leaves no place for cowboys.
Mr. Frauenknecht, you have plenty of spare parts here in Switzerland. You have the plans. Now help us to get one or the other, and you could save my country from destruction. Now, that may sound dramatic to you, but our military planners know that without aircraft, the next war will be our last.
I'd like to help.
So how can you get us the spares?
I can't. Sulzer's license agreement with the French is very strict.
There must be ways.
Well, maybe, but not at my level. You'd have to go to Schmidt or even higher.
Okay. So how do we convince Schmidt?
Well, he's a businessman. He's got an eye for a good deal. If he thinks you've got a big order, he might lean on his military connections. He knows all the key people. He might try to persuade them to release some Mirage spares. If he thought there was something in it for Sulzer's.
Would he do that?
Can try.
Can you arrange a meeting with Schmidt?
fall in love.
I'm sorry. If Schmidt had been keen to help, he would have been a lot more positive than he was. He's not short of friends in high places.
You mean he's against Jews?
No, on the contrary. Like most Swiss, he's very sympathetic to Israel.
Until it comes to actual concrete help.
He's a careful man.
A good, careful, law-abiding Swiss.
Yes?
Like the good, careful Swiss who during the war sealed the borders and sent the German Jews back to the Nazis.
I can't possibly help you get those spares.
Oh.
Perhaps I can help you to make your own.
We've already decided that it would take 6 years to build our own engine.
Not if you had the plans.
Are you trying to say that you're willing to slip us the plans?
Have you any idea how many plans there are for this engine?
How many?
About 160,000. I mean, if somebody wanted to shift them in one go, it would take a couple of railway wagons.
So many plans for one engine?
It's not just the engine. Each part needs maybe 20 special tools. I mean, tools need plans as well, you know. And you need to know how to use the tools to make the part, how to put the parts together. Every little screw needs a plan.
That's impossible.
That's not impossible. The most important thing is the drawing specification book.
What's that?
Well, it's a kind of catalogue of all the plans. If you've got that, then you see exactly what's involved.
Can you get that for us?
Well, I am technical coordinator in the jet engine division. It would be perfectly in order for me to take it home in the evening and study it.
Monday.
Monday.
Right. Excellent. That's the business over, so let's have a good night on the town.
No, just a moment, Colonel Carter. This is a very risky business for me. Firstly, it must not harm Switzerland. And then I shall need some insurance.
Insurance?
Yes. If I do this for you, it's breaking Swiss military law. I'm breaking my contract with Sulzer. If anything should go wrong and I lose my job, I want sufficient insurance money for my wife and me for the rest of our lives.
How much?
$250,000.
That's a lot of money.
It's a lot of risk for me and my family.
Well, obviously, I shall have to speak to Jerusalem about it. You bring the drawing specification book on Monday, and I'll tell you if they okay your price.
It's not a price. It's an insurance.
Frauenknecht was committed. Now he had to establish a cover story.
Ernst, an idea. The Mirage engine project is coming to an end. We ought to be looking ahead.
Well, there's still a modification.
One thing to do is to clear as much space as possible.
I don't know.
For example, all those plans taking up a valuable room.
Oh, yes, well, we have to keep them for 10 years, you know.
Precisely. Large room for 10 years.
And microfilm, that's the answer.
All of them. Why do half a job?
We don't need them like this anymore. Much more economical to store them on microfilm.
Well,
let's do a feasibility study. So that we can say to Mr. Schmidt that in the long run, it will save space and money. You understand?
Yes, Mr. Flemyng. The problem is this. Do we microfilm just the plans that are here or all of them? After all, 80% of them are out with subcontractors. Virtually every major engineering works has got a few.
Yes, that's a very good point. We're the licensees. We're responsible for those plans. Get them all in. We'll do the lot.
You know these subcontractors. There's sure to be some missing.
There's no problem. We'll get duplicates from France if necessary. We must have a complete set.
Margaret, will you get out a complete list of all the subcontractors and the plans which they hold, please?
All right, Willem.
Oh, have you finished with the drawing specification booking?
Yes.
Drop it into me, will you, please? I want to take it home and give it a careful read just to see the size of the problem.
Right.
What's all the rush?
Now, you know perfectly well I don't like messing about. If we're going to do a job, then we must get on and do it.
It's good to see you again.
Good to see you.
Have you brought the specification book?
I have. You brought my insurance.
Well, I don't like to say this, but as you know, we're a very poor country. Well, the war has cost us a lot. And you're asking for a lot of money.
You're asking for a lot of plans.
We'll guarantee you a job in Israel. We can fix it.
I'm a good Swiss Catholic. I do not want to live in Israel. Look, I'm going to a lot of trouble to set this up. You can't expect me to do it for nothing.
$125,000 paid anywhere in the world.
No, it's not enough.
You see, it's an additional financial burden to us.
It is one-tenth the price of a single Mirage. $200,000.
You're a hard man.
I am.
All right, it's agreed.
Installments on every delivery.
If you insist.
I insist.
Shall we drink on it now? Or shall we finish the business first, then go out and let the Israeli government buy us a good meal and a night on the town?
Fine by me.
No. In the car. You see, I'm a very generous man. 55,000 francs for a paperback I can't understand. So, have you come up with an idea of how you're going to move your two wagon loads of stuff?
It's coming along. I've been pretty busy.
I would like to report something. Jerusalem is pressing.
Yes, I can understand that. Well, there are four groups of plans. First and most important are the drawings of the actual parts themselves. Fortunately, this is the smallest group. You need these right away. I can bring them to you in bundles of 200 or 300 every couple of weeks.
Great. When do we start?
In answer to your question, we can start next week. The rest will have to follow later, after the microfilming.
You're going to microfilm 160,000 plans? I think they spot you.
No. I've arranged for Sulzer's microphone department to do it. I think they might have to expand a little.
Do Sulzer's know that they're going to have to set up an espionage department?
Well, the job has to be done anyway.
Oh, yes, yes, of course, of course. So the problem is solved, huh? Microfilm is so easy to smuggle.
But I can't give you the microphone.
Oh, you can't give me the microphone. What you going to do?
It's impossible for me to have two sets of the plans made. No, you'll have to have the originals.
Oh, yes, I see, of course, yes. After the microfilming, you put the original drawings in an envelope and post it to the Israeli embassy in Bern.
No. Evidently, the Israeli government couldn't afford the postage. I'll find a way.
Excuse me, I'm looking for Joseph Frauenknecht. Have you seen him?
Oh, you'll find him back there.
Joseph?
Yeah, yeah.
Hello, Joseph.
Fred, what are you doing?
Well, I can only spare a few minutes, actually, but I was wondering if you'd like to do a job for me. I'm setting up this new business deal, and I need a driver, so I thought, Cousin Joseph, keep it in the family. It involves collecting some special paper and delivering a few packages, but you might have to go all over the country, that's the only thing.
My car's clapped out.
Do this for me, I'll buy you a new one.
Hey, you must be doing all right out of this. Wait till I tell Maria.
No, don't tell Maria. In fact, don't tell anybody. It has to be absolutely secret.
Why?
But it's a secret process. Patents pending.
Ah. Yeah, well, what shall I tell Maria about the new car, then?
I'll tell her you won the money on the state lottery.
Hey, there's nothing dodgy about this, is there?
Joseph, you know me.
Yeah. When do I start?
Immediately. First thing I want you to do is to buy a reliable van and hire a lock-up garage to keep it in.
A van as well as a car?
Then I want you to drive around all the engineering works, builders' yards, not sorters, I'll organise that, scrap dealers, that kind of thing, and I want you to buy up this special paper, but it has to be this kind, yes?
Scrap paper, taking out where your father left off. You'll be selling old bones next.
Did they ask? Just say that it's for a special process.
Yeah, but what is it?
Making plastic. Don't say anything else, otherwise you'll blow it.
Hello, Joseph. Joseph, I'm very busy. Maria wants to see the lottery.
Sorry, I seem to have come at the wrong time.
Oh, it's all right. Hang on. I will be a minute. Perhaps you'd like to come sign those requests to the subcontractors for their plans.
Yes, sir.
We're here. Joseph. Well, all right, I'll make one. Well, of course it'll be all right. I'm a draftsman. I'm sorry, Joseph. Seems to be getting a bit hectic in here.
No, it's all right. I was just wondering how you were going to destroy the originals after the microfilming.
Burn them in an incinerator.
Yes, well, I've been thinking. Perhaps we ought to get a paper shredder.
Paper shredder? Mm. Hello, Frank. Oh, good. The film stock arrived. And the new enlarger? And is the viewer the right size? Excellent. Well, let me know when you're ready to start filming. Yes, I will. Bye. Yes, the paper shredder. Ernst, totally honest. I do feel personally responsible for the security of these plans, and I'd be much happier if I saw them burnt completely myself.
Oh, well, very well. As long as you don't make a bonfire in my office, you can burn away to your heart's content.
Excuse me, Mr. Frankneck.
Yes?
I'm having terrible difficulties with Mr. Kreutzmann at Remax. He says it will cause them too much trouble to get the plans back to us, and they've lost about 50 sheets.
Hello, Kreutzmann. Frank, thank you. Now, what is all this about you're having... Oh, what are you running there, a factory or a kindergarten? Well, these are top secret military plans, you know, so you'd better find them, even if it means tearing the place apart. I don't care if you're busy. I'm busy too, you know. Obviously, Remax isn't up to making military components. Would you like me to tell that to the Air Force? No, I didn't think you would. Get those plans back to me and get them back fast. Now, I'm paying you to do that. If you need to shout at them, shout.
All right. Stranger worries you. Give the plans to your cousin and let him deliver them to you.
He's not crossing at all, nor am I. You're the professionals, you get them out.
So what are you complaining about? You give the plans to Stranger at this little factory and he'll get them out.
He's crossing a border.
He crosses a border every day. He lives in Switzerland, he works in Germany. The company's got one factory in Switzerland and another just across the border in Germany. He's the boss's chauffeur running between the two. He's like a bloody unit. The guards won't stop him.
What if they do?
So what do you want him to do? Eat the plans in Switzerland and ship them out in Germany? You know you're not happy unless you're worrying. You're like an old Jewish mother. Yes, I know I've seen them, but business first. How about your payments?
Insurance.
All right, insurance. But do you have to have your premiums paid in cash? I don't like carrying all this cash around.
Pay them into the bank, then. I've opened 3 numbered accounts. Here you are. I'll give you the numbers.
Would it be safer in a foreign bank? America, Germany, London, we'll pay it in anywhere.
Nope, safer here. There you are.
Have you chosen a code name for your account?
Yes, Romeo.
It figures. Nothing like a bank to make a Swiss feel romantic.
You say that to me, a Jew and a Romanian?
Do you know the difference between a Romanian and a Swiss? They both sell their grandmothers, but the Swiss would deliver.
Of course. But crossing the border with her is extra.
Thank you.
scheme was simple. Instead of taking the original plans to the incinerator, he took them to Cousin Joseph's garage. There, they would be switched for the waste paper Joseph had collected for the bogus plastics process. Packaged to look like the plans, the waste paper would be taken to the incinerator. Meanwhile, the real plans would be stored till a way was found to deliver them across the border into Germany and on to Israel.
Give me the keys. You go and have your breakfast.
Where are you going?
Stop asking questions. I'm not telling you all my business. I'll be back in an hour.
Morning. Frauenknecht's first rendezvous with the contact who will drive the plans across the border. The Israelis have chosen shrewdly, a company chauffeur well known to the frontier guards, therefore unlikely to be stopped and searched.
Mr. Frauenknecht. I'm told you have some goods for me.
Yes, I have. But they're rather delicate. Is the way clear?
Factory's deserted. No one works on Saturdays. Follow me. I'll be over the border in a few hours.
Don't tell me, I don't want to know.
Thank you.
Herr Schwimmer, it's kind. It worked. Believe it or not, it worked like a dream. They'll be with you tomorrow. And we've already got all the really important stuff for copying direct from Falkenecht. Excellent, eh? So this is all bonus. You know, he's a clever little guy. You know, he's got 50 people working on this at Sulzer's and they don't even know. Yeah. Another 5 deliveries like this and we'll have the lot. Amazing. I mean, getting a couple of formula out in a micro dot is one thing. But the chutzpah to bring out tons of plans by the van load, eh? Yeah. Okay. I'll tell him.
Now, just a minute. Come on. Do this one again, will you?
Why?
It's only the third run. You're getting careless already.
Why all this fuss about a bit of plastic?
Because the details are important. If you work for me, you do as you're told.
You'll be glad when it's all over, no doubt.
Yes, yes. We're nearly 2/3 of the way through now. My secretary.
I must say, it's a very efficient operation. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Great deal of planning gone into this.
Yes, yes.
Ed, can I remind you that this is classified material?
Oh, sorry. It's just that I couldn't help noticing that some of those sheets were blank.
Ah, to the untrained eye, they may appear to be blank.
This plastics business hasn't worked out then?
No, not as well as I'd hoped. This is the last run.
So that's the end of the money?
Yes. I've lost quite a bit on it already.
What about my car?
Well, I'm a generous man. You can keep the car.
Thank you.
Show me breakfast. Everything all right? Have you checked the factory?
Forget it. You know the place is deserted on Saturdays.
Well, that's the last time. It's all over. Goodbye. And thank you. Franknecht. Hello? You're who? Where's Colonel Kine? In Israel? I'm sorry, this is a very bad line. You're in Rome. You'll have to speak up. The flowers are what? Spoiled? I'm sorry, I don't understand. You'll have to repeat. Hello?
Is anything wrong?
No one.
Oh, Captain Knott from the military department just phoned. He can't make the Dubendorf conference in the morning.
Oh, bloody bureaucrats. All right, get him for me, will you?
Captain Knott, Mr. Franknecht for you.
Hello, Knott.
I'm terribly sorry, Mr. Franknecht. I'm afraid I can't come to the meeting tomorrow. You see, some classified material was found near Basel on Saturday. I've got to go and sort it out.
Oh, I see. Has anyone been arrested, yes?
Oh, no, not yet. The police don't even know what it's about. It seems that a company chauffeur has been storing plans, stolen, obviously, in a factory garage. The owner discovered it all on Saturday morning, quite by chance. They're all marked Sulzer, top secret, so they could be plans for the Mirage. The chauffeur disappeared over the border. Till I go and look at these plans, we just don't know.
Give me Schmidt. He's in Denmark.
Not your boss, Munsinger, is he with you?
No, he went to England on Friday. Look, I'm very sorry about the meeting. I'm the only one here.
Look, I don't see any reason why you need miss the meeting. I can tell you about the material found in Basel.
You know something about it?
Well, I think I can save you a trip to the border. It is rather complicated to talk on the phone. I'd appreciate it if we could meet sometime today.
I don't think you quite understand, Mr. Franknecht. You are charged with economic espionage and breaking the code of Swiss military secrecy.
Do you mind if I just excuse myself from the meeting?
Not at all.
Gentlemen, unfortunately, I've been called away on some urgent business. Mr. Dreyfus will deputize for me in my absence. Good morning.
Alfred Franknecht went to jail for 4.5 years. But the Israelis made good use of his plans and built their own version of the Mirage, which saw active service in the 1973 Yom Kippur War. The Swiss government confiscated Franknecht's insurance. He now designs bridges.
preceding program was made possible by this and other public television stations.
McNeil Air News Hour tonight at 11.
This week.